You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes.
Former high school coach was charged this afternoon with having sex with a teenage girl. The Lackawanna County District Attorney says 27-year-old Philip Godlewski of Scranton began the relationship with the girl when she was just 15 years old. Godlewski is a former baseball coach at Riverside High School. He currently coaches for the Taylor American Legion baseball team in Lackawanna County.
I put myself in this situation. So that's where the burden is always on me for everything that has happened here.
You can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
I was 24, 25 years old. I thought I could help the girl.
Go tell that long-tongued liar. Go and tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down.
There's two people that know what happened between me and that girl. Two people only. Me and the girl.
Well, my goodness gracious, let me tell you the news. My head's been wet with the midnight dew. I've been down on bended knee, talking to the man from Galilee. He spoke to me with a voice so sweet. I thought I heard the shuffle of angels sweep. He called my name and my heart stood still. When he said, John, go do my will. Go tell that long-tongued liar. Go and tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down.
I put myself in that position, and I will continue to suffer for it for the rest of my life.
Yet another QAnon influencer has turned out to actually be that which they have fought against for so long. Here we're talking about Phil Godlewski, who accidentally ended up outing himself as an alleged child predator when he chose to launch a lawsuit against a newspaper. As we so often say, people throw around threats of lawsuits against what they claim is defamation very commonly. But when you do that, you open yourself up to discovery. You open yourself up to things being rooted around the past. In this case, Phil Godlewski's past has come back to bite him.
After a local newspaper published a story about Godlewski having this relationship with this girl, he sued them for defamation. The problem for Godlewski, though, is that there's written evidence in the form of text messages between the two of them, including details about their sexual encounters.
This is according to one of the messages. Realize that you're only 15, but quickly stopped caring. Why are we so compatible? I'm 10 years older than you. So look, obviously at this point, he knew that he was doing wrong. I mean, he had known all along that he was doing wrong, but he continued to go for it. Couldn't help himself.
He was indicted on a raft of charges related to the alleged sexual relationship. In her recent affidavit, BD claims that he contacted her and begged her to recant her claims against him, threatening to kill himself if she didn't. In response, she stopped cooperating with law enforcement in the case. He ultimately pleaded guilty to a lesser count of corruption of a minor, receiving 3 months under house arrest. Now, he denies that there was ever a sexual relationship, but remember, through that discovery process in the defamation lawsuit, you learn about the text messages. You learn about the evidence in that case. So you can deny it all you want, but you put it in writing, you idiot.
We probably had sex like 40% in the homes of northeastern Pennsylvania, the woman responded. An apparent allusion to Godlewski's alleged habit when she was still underage, or using his second job as a real estate agent to access for sale houses for the liaisons. this just gets worse and worse. You could have bought and are living in a house that a pedophile was fucking raping a kid in. That's fucked up.
Grifter. A grifter is a con artist, someone who swindles people out of money through fraud. Fraud. A person that intends to deceive others, typically by unjustifiably claiming or being credited with accomplishments or qualities intended to result in financial or personal gain. Pedophile. A person who is sexually attracted to a child. Child. A child refers to an individual who is a minor, who is below legal age or the age of majority. The age of majority being 18 in most states. The internet is a very difficult place to earn someone's trust. To earn it, one has to be consistent in much of what they do. They need to follow through on their promises and work hard to live up to the expectations they have set. Promises and expectations are conveyed through words. Trust develops then by being true to your word. In recent years, mainstream media has lost its credibility. Waves of people have lost their trust in it. So many truth-seeking patriots took to social media to find answers. With it, many average Janes and Joes with a webcam and a microphone were lifted into a spotlight, sharing research they had found or intel they were given, some getting rich and somewhat famous in the process. This mainstream media alternative was made up of podcasts, films, blogs, and social media posts. The sphere of theories and theorists became known as the truther community, and the effect it had upon us was called the Great Awakening. But average viewers, or seekers of truth, if not careful, would replace their blind allegiance from one source of information to another. Some smart and inquisitive viewers learned that the mainstream media news belonged to a group of six parent companies, meaning all mainstream media could be easily used to manipulate the public. When some made the jump to an alternative news source, they didn't care to question who they were getting their information from, so long as it fit their new narrative and it provided comfort. This confirmation bias seemed to be all that mattered until recently. Some podcasters, or truthers as we'll call them, willingly told their stories with hopes to gain trust and confidence in their audience. Certain personalities were so charismatic, it didn't matter who the person was. What mattered was the information they had to give and how they gave it. But over time, and after gaining a bit of stardom, some truthers digressed from journalism and evolved into sensationalism. They chose to say what people wanted to hear, rather than what they thought was true. They became advertisers, their focus becoming more fixed on income than being of service. There are many truthers in this information war fighting for humanity, and making money from it isn't necessarily a bad thing. One deserves it if they are rightfully earning it, but to earn that money grifting, that's where it's wrong. That's where God intervenes. A grifter is a con artist, someone who swindles people out of money through fraud. And a fraud is a person who lies for financial or personal gain. Under normal circumstances, I wouldn't make a film calling out a grifter in this movement, but let it be known to those who are unaware, the truther community was built upon a few pillars, one being the exposure of child sex trafficking and pedophilia. To add, the Great Awakening is built upon the fact that many governments and three-letter agencies have much to do with the foundation and continuation of child sex trafficking. With this film, I'm not just calling out a grifter amongst us, but a pedophile, hiding behind a mic, thinking we'd never question him because of it. Every podcaster has its loyalist, like a person who only drinks Coke and never tries Pepsi, or a liberal who prefers CNN over anything else. Similarly, many truthers stay in their own space and don't have a good idea of who other truthers are. That is, unless people make a loud noise about it. Also in this movement, people are afraid to call anyone out, fearing the common feedback of unity, not division. But what if someone has actually been dividing the movement regularly by lying their teeth off, grifting millions into their pocket, and hiding the fact that they're a pedophile? Who's going to actually stand up to them? I spend a lot of my time in chats. I engage often with my audience. I don't run a podcast like I used to. I stick to making films. I mind my own business, and with some of my free time, I hang out on social media. If I had been too busy, I'd never have learned who was the most vile, dangerous, evil, and disgusting perverted pedophile in our movement. Had I learned he was just a fraud, I probably would have let it go. But I learned he was a pedophile, and that's when I decided to make this film. Recently, I've reflected upon the months I've spent truly upset at how gullible and undiscerning people had become. I saw through social media posts how easy it was to convince people of stupid things. I saw that people had low standards for what they qualified as truth. People were getting lazy, outsourcing their thinking to other people. A side-by-side photo was all they needed to say a woman was a man, that Elvis was still alive, or Edward Snowden was Phil Godlewski. I felt particularly responsible for this because I had made so many films exposing conspiracies in depth, and now people were so easily spreading ridiculous theories, and not many seemed to care about whether it was true or not. The emotional response became more important than the logical response. A lot of people stopped caring for receipts. It appeared that what mattered most was whatever fit the narrative they had in mind. This made many people vulnerable to grifters, to scam artists, and cheats. This film is not a conspiracy theory. It's backed with facts and receipts, and that's the only way I'd have it. Because this film exposes who I believe to be the greatest fraud in our movement. That person being Phil Godlewski. I can say without a doubt, he is a grifter, he is a fraud, and he is a pedophile. By the end of this film, you'll know what a trino really looks like. What's a trino? A truther in name only. For the many who have no idea who Phil is, let this film be a character study. One where you learn the traits of a narcissistic sociopath whose uncontrollable lust for greed and attention exposed his dark past and spiraled him out of control. This was meant to be a great awakening for all of us, but for Phil's audience, it's become the fake awakening. So now, let's try to wake everyone up. As a voice in this movement, I cannot stand by and do nothing when there is a pedophile grifter committing high levels of fraud in this movement. Pretending to be one of us. He may not be considered by everyone, but he certainly is to me, the greatest fraud on earth. Much of this film uses court documents, sworn affidavits, podcast live streams, and text messages, leaving no room for theory or deceit. This in turn equips you, the viewer, with all the receipts to combat Phil's deceit. This film is divided into three parts. Part one is that Phil is a pedophile. Part two is that he is a grifter. And part three is that he's finished. What you'll find common throughout all parts, without a doubt, is that Phil Godlewski is a liar.
The perplexity paradox.
Liar, liar.
Of the wrong
pants on
institution.
Fire. See a squirm.
Comes
see
freely.
Perspire.
Upon the chill.
Not a word you say is true.
Of those.
There's never been one out of you. Smoking mirrors.
Exacerbates.
Bait and switch. You and your friends are getting rich.
Each order.
Picking pockets. And pulling strings. Another.
The rival.
More despicable things.
Perplexity.
Liar. Liar. Pants on fire. Preaching only to the choir. Photo op in front of the steeple. How did you manage to fool these people?
You don't get away with anything in God's eyes. So if you think you're getting away with something and no one else knows about it, he knows.
Philip Godlewski was taken into custody late this afternoon. Police say the 27-year-old started having a sexual relationship with a 15-year-old girl in 2008. He met her while working as a baseball coach and helped her cope with the loss of her boyfriend. Detectives say they've obtained thousands of text messages linking the pair. They also say Godlewski gave her gifts and even a brand new car.
We also executed a search warrant on two vehicles, two Infiniti vehicles. Those vehicles, we allege, were instrumentalities of the crime. They were things that were used by the defendant in order to commit the crimes that he's charged with, in essence, to engage in sexual behavior with this child.
Act One, the crime.
I did not do anything inappropriate with this girl, not in my estimation. Never did anything inappropriate with that girl when she was underage. That was all fabricated.
Why is it important to show the receipts that Phil is a pedophile? Well, because he has invested a lot of time and energy into lying about it. There are many people who follow him who haven't seen the timeline of events in all the documents to prove them. More importantly, he threatens to sue anyone for defamation if they show the receipts publicly.
I will sue you into oblivion.
The threats have actually worked to silence some into submission.
Phil G is not a pedophile. He's never been charged as a pedophile. And we are totally redacting anything and everything that we've ever said about Phil G.
But not all are built so cowardly. As you'll soon see, the evidence is profound, mainly the text messages. After reviewing a decades-long timeline of events, there's no doubt in my mind the text messages are real and that Phil is a pedophile. The timeline will walk you through the path of understanding that, when finished, will leave no doubt in your mind, too. December 2008. Phil Godlewski repeatedly has sex with a minor. On October 31st, 2022, lines 4 through 6 of Bree's sworn affidavit in the Godlewski v. Scranton Times defamation suit would reveal the details of her and Phil's sexual relationship. Specifically, when she states, "On November 10th, 2008, my boyfriend Joseph Strock committed suicide. I was very upset by his death. Shortly before Joseph Strock's death, I met Philip Godlewski. I began communicating with him after Joseph's death. Philip Godlewski was 10 years older than me. Within a couple of months after Joseph Strock's death, I began having a sexual relationship with Philip Godlewski. I was 15 years old when we started our sexual relationship." If she were lying, everything that would unravel from here on out wouldn't make sense. What makes sense is she's telling the truth. January 27th, 2009. Bree's parents find out about the relationship and tell the school. It would only take Bree's parents 1 to 2 months to find out about the inappropriate relationship between their daughter and her school's baseball coach. In an effort to end the relationship, they wrote the school's principal an email. "Per your request, we are stating the disturbing fact that we have recently become aware that our daughter Bree, age 15 and a freshman at Riverside, has been engaged in a relationship with an adult male employed by the Riverside School District. His name is Phil Godlewski. Our daughter has admitted this relationship to both of us, as well as to her counselor. From November of 2008 to the present, she has received numerous gifts from this man, including diamond earrings from Zales Jewelers, a diamond sapphire necklace, an expensive hat, as well as some other items. Linda has heard them speaking on the phone and has phone records to prove that they have spoken and texted during school hours throughout the days and long into the nights. This relationship is clearly inappropriate, and we fully support any action taken by the district, such as the removal of this man from the coaching staff. Thank you for your attention to this matter." This email worked, as Phil was fired, and the two stopped talking for about a year. February 2010. Phil reached out to Bree a year later, and the two started having sex again. In Bree's counterclaim affidavit from the Scranton Times defamation lawsuit, lines 2 and 3 state, "I received numerous text messages from Philip Godlewski during the time period from February 24th, 2010 through March 12th, 2010. Around March 12th or 13th, my mother provided my cell phone to the Taylorboro police as evidence of my sexual relationship with Philip Godlewski." March 19th, 2010. A forensic interview was held with Bree and her parents. In the affidavit of probable cause filed by detectives Mancuso and Larry, along with officers McGovern and Derenick, we learned that on March 19, 2010, Bree and her parents met Detective Mancuso at the Children's Advocacy Center for a forensic interview. This is where Bree came forward to the police. It's important to note, what is probable cause? Probable cause is a requirement found in the Fourth Amendment that must usually be met before police make an arrest, conduct a search, or receive a warrant. Courts usually find probable cause when there is a reasonable basis for believing that a crime may have been committed for an arrest, or when evidence of the crime is present in the place to be searched. On June 17, 2010, a search warrant signed by the Honorable Margaret Moyle, Judge of the Court of Common Pleas of Lackawanna County, was faxed to Verizon Wireless for text message content. On June 25th, 2010, Verizon Wireless responded to the search warrant and mailed a CD containing the requested content to Detective Larry. Detective Larry reviewed the text messages and call history content and noted multiple items of interest, including text messages to and from Godlewski to Neslo and text messages to the victim regarding creating a fake story to law enforcement. For those wondering, both Neslo and Godlewski were charged for corrupting the same minor. On July 7th, 2010, Detective Mancuso re-interviewed Bree. She stated that prior to coming to the Lackawanna County District Attorney's Office, she had been receiving text messages from Phil. She stated the text message content was relating to the ongoing investigation. She also stated that she deleted the text messages as per instruction by Godlewski. On July 8th, 2010, Detective Larry was conducting a forensic exam on the victim's cell phone. Detective Larry located a new text sent to the victim. The text content led Detective Larry to believe the number was an additional prepaid cell phone obtained by Godlewski to converse covertly with the victim. On July 9th, 2010, the police filed a criminal complaint as they had collected enough facts to claim probable cause.
I was charged with 8 felonies and 13 misdemeanors, ranging from involuntary deviant sexual assault, indecent assault, criminal use of communication facility, that was a felony charge, that was facing well over 25 years in prison.
This led to the inevitable, Phil's arrest.
I was very shocked by the arrest. Kind of came out of left field for me.
Eyewitness News first told you a former Riverside baseball coach is under arrest tonight on sex crime charges. Philip Godlewski was taken into custody late.
Front page of the newspaper, 2 days in a row. Top news story, WNEP, 2 days in a row. The guys that were in jail, tried to block this out of memory, but the guys that were in jail knew why I was in jail.
Former high school coach was charged this afternoon with having sex with a teenage girl. The Lackawanna County.
I didn't think I was going to make it out of there without getting severely hurt or possibly killed. And instead of me going to general population where I would have almost certainly been killed or beaten, I was kept in the medical wing for the 7 days that I was in there before I was able to get out.
But in September 2010, Bree, the victim, pulled out of the case. On October 31st, 2022, Bree would admit in a sworn affidavit why she backed out of the case. On line 11, she admits, "After Philip Godlewski was arrested, he pleaded with me not to testify against him and said he would commit suicide if I testified against him. In response to Phil Godlewski's pleas and just wanting the situation to end, I stopped cooperating with the district attorney's office during the criminal case against him, and I refused to testify against Philip Godlewski at the preliminary hearing in the criminal case." Now it makes sense. Phil knew her boyfriend committed suicide, so he used that against her. On November 12, 2010, Phil pled guilty. Without her cooperation, the case was dropped. they could only give Phil a misdemeanor plea deal of corrupting a minor. According to Phil's court documents, on November 12, 2010, he pled guilty to PA 6301 A1 to M1. According to Phil's police criminal complaint from July 2010, 6301 A1 included sexual intercourse and was considered an M1. Phil, of course, forgets all these facts and makes up his own.
There's three different corruption of morals charges in Pennsylvania, three different levels: misdemeanor 1, misdemeanor 2, and misdemeanor 3. Misdemeanor 1 is the sexual variety, where you actually had contact with the victim. Misdemeanor 2, and misdemeanor 1, you also have to register as a sex offender. Misdemeanor 2 is also sexual contact, but you don't have to register. Misdemeanor 3 has nothing to do with sexual anything. That's what I pled to. 3.
It says, did you corrupt or intend to corrupt, if you're over 18 years of age, did you corrupt or intend to corrupt the morals of someone under the age of 18? It's a very loosey, and that's all it says. There's nothing about sexually or anything that you guys like to throw out there to make me look worse than I actually am. There's no sexual anything related to any of that. Those charges come in with the misdemeanor 2 and the misdemeanor 3. 3 is the worst one because you have to register as a sex offender.
Misdemeanor 3 has nothing to do with sexual anything.
3 is the worst one because you have to register as a sex offender.
That's what I pled to. 3.
On December 6th, 2010, corruption of a minor charge was changed. It appears the specific charge was amended on October 7th, 2010, and was scheduled to take effect 60 days from that date. So on December 6th, 2010, the corruption of a minor charge had changed. The sexual offenses went from a misdemeanor in the first degree to an F3, a felony in the third degree. Let's say, for example, if Phil was arrested, charged, and pled guilty to the same crime on or after December 6th, 2010, his corruption of minors sexual offense charge would have been a felony in the third degree, and he would have been required to register as a sex offender after serving jail time. On July 11th, 2011, Phil was officially sentenced. The court case was abandoned as a result of threats to Bree. As he succeeded in silencing her, the text message content would stay hidden in an evidence room to be lost forever. Nobody would have guessed that because of Phil, 10 years later, those text messages would resurface.
I'm suing everybody.
When I filed that defamation lawsuit against the Scranton Times, I knew all of this was going to come out. And you know what? I didn't give a shit. I didn't care. Want to know why? Because those text messages are fabricated. They're not real. I proved it once. And when I get in front of the jury for my defamation trial against the Times, I'm going to prove it again. Brian Cates, lawyer up. You're next. Jeanette Geary, keep running. Because we will serve you, and you will go to court for what you did to me. Jordan Sather, lawyer up. Dave from X22, lawyer up. I'm coming after every one of you, and you will not stop me. And if you think I'm bluffing, look at my face. I'm the captain now. You're gonna play my game. And if any of you other simpletons out there, like the trolls on Rumble or the trolls on Telegram or the ones on Facebook. If you want to take me on, let me know, because I'll come after you too. I'll spend a small fortune chasing down each and every one of you. You have no idea the amount of fire that exists inside of me when it comes to this.
Well, it's been 18 months since those lawsuit threats, and none of them have been served. Turns out, the captain was bluffing. This is a common scare tactic of Phil's. He's all bark and no bite. Deep down, he knows he's a pedophile. He'd be really stupid to actually sue anyone for defamation. Yet, when he actually did, he chose the worst possible opponent, the Scranton Times Tribune, the local newspaper in Scranton, Pennsylvania.
I will win this case. Rest assured, I will win this case.
The timeline goes like this. On February 14th, 2021, Chris Kelly writes the Scranton Times article. It wasn't until an article written by Chris Kelly of the Scranton Times that Phil's past of pedophilia would catch up to him. Being that Phil claimed himself to be a member of Q, an anonymous team of white hats performing a massive government operation, it was no surprise that columnist Chris Kelly, who had known about Phil's past, would find it all very ironic. Kelly most likely chuckled, wondering how Phil could claim to be a white hat on the Q team, the secret organization behind exposing worldwide pedophilia, while being a pedophile himself. Phil became outraged, and finally, after threatening to sue 30 truthers in the community, he chose to sue the Scranton Times. July 2021, Phil sued Chris Kelly for defamation. In retaliation to the article, Phil started a fundraiser, then sued the Scranton Times, claiming he didn't have sex with a minor and that the article was defamation.
I did not, under any circumstances, have any sort of sexual relations with a minor. I did not do that.
Little did Phil know, this would begin the process of discovery, and the text messages hiding in an evidence room from the 2010 case would finally resurface, ultimately providing the receipts that verified Phil Godlewski as a pedophile.
One of the QAnon leaders turns out to be a pedophile, and we learn this because he also happens to be incredibly stupid and decided to file a defamation lawsuit, an ill-fated defamation lawsuit that led to a discovery process where we learned about the case involving him sleeping with a 15-year-old girl.
This was a guy who not only wanted apparently to sleep with a 15-year-old, but wanted to leave the biggest paper trail possible. And so there's texts that he sent about how he would only be sexually satisfied if they had sex 4 to 5 times a day.
Text messages from the time were particularly incriminating, with Godlewski making several explicit references to the sexual nature of their relationship and to the fact that she was only 15 years old and that he was 25 years old. This contradicts the claim by Godlewski's lawyer that the girl was of age before the relationship turned sexual.
Those text messages are fabricated. They're not real. I proved it once, and when I get in front of the jury for my defamation trial against the Times, I'm going to prove it again.
No matter what he tries to say, the texts are real and were handed over from Verizon to the court. Have a look between the text Phil says he entered as evidence, but never did, compared to the text Verizon delivered to the court. What looks more believable to you, Verizon's or Phil's? What's even more disturbing is the person we discover in these texts. Have a look. Yet despite the discovery of the text messages, Phil still thought he could win. What would make Phil so confident in suing the newspaper?
Do you still think you will win the Scranton Times lawsuit? Yeah. And honestly, it's not even going to really be a closely... it's not going to be close. Yeah, I'm going to win that lawsuit. Hands down. And they're going to be regretting they didn't take the deal I offered them several months ago. They're doomed. Here's the thing, guys. They said I slept with a minor. They said it in a major publication. They did it with malice. Now you got to prove it. And my charges that I have on my record have nothing to do with sleeping with a minor. So now you got to go out and prove that I slept with a minor. Let me tell you something. You can't prove that. Want to know why? Because it didn't happen. So no matter what they do or who they subpoena or what text messages they read, by the way, the text messages were a flop. They know that now. So now they're subpoenaing whoever they could to try to draw out time in hopes that, you know, they're going to run the clock out on me and I'm going to run out of money. Good luck. That's going to a jury. There's probably a certain amount of money that I would settle for if it included apologies, retractions, and stuff like that. But I have to deal with those accusations and those comments for the rest of my life. That article's still live. Still up on their website. Every day that it's there is another dollar in the bank. For the rest of my life, I'll have to answer to that article. So will my kids. And they're going to be punished for that. There's two people that know what happened between me and that girl, and two people only, me and the girl. And I have a feeling that both of us, when deposed, are going to say the same thing. Because what I've been saying is the truth, and I feel like she is going to also tell the truth. So, let's keep watching.
On February 6th, 2023, Bree speaks at the discovery hearing. During the discovery hearing between Mr. Timothy Hinton, the Scranton Times lawyer, and Bree, Phil's victim, Bree admits under oath that Phil attempted to bribe her. Hinton questions, "Now, Bree, after Phil talked to you about a windfall and a financial opportunity in voicing his disgust for the Scranton Times, we'll call it, did you speak to him by phone about what he was proposing to you?" "Yes, I did." "And tell us about that conversation, please. Can you tell us when you talked to him after these text messages?" "About a month or two ago." "About a month or two ago?" "About 2 months." "2 months ago, okay. Tell us about the conversation you had with Mr. Godlewski." "He said he would offer me $50,000, and I kind of just laughed it off as a joke because I don't think he would ever really do that." "What did he want in return for paying you $50,000? "He wanted me to be on his side." "Did he get more specific as to what he was looking for you in terms of your sexual relationship with him?"
"No, not really."
"Okay. Did he ask you to change the age that the two of you had sex together?" "He just wanted me to say that I was older." "Older than 15? 18. "He wanted you to say that you were 18 when you had sex?"
"Correct."
"And what did you say in response to him?"
"I said I can't lie under oath."
"He only sued Scranton Times because he thought he could get away with it by buying his victim with $50,000. His confidence was now the chink in his armor, and this created the downhill snowball for Godlewski. He was now stuck in a defamation suit, being fully exposed from all directions. March 27th, 2023. Phil sues Bree. Bree countersues Phil. Phil was so outraged, his plan failed. Bree had denied the $50,000 offer. The text messages were circling around the media and the podcast sphere. Yet somehow Phil decided his only option left was to sue Bree.
But on July 18th, 2023, Bree countersued Phil Godlewski for defamation and, more importantly, assault and battery for the crimes committed in 2010. Under Title 42 of Pennsylvania Code 5533, she still had time to do it. Title 42, Section B2I states, if an individual entitled to bring a civil action arising from sexual abuse is under 18 years of age at the time the cause of action accrues, the individual shall have a period of 37 years after attaining 18 years of age in which to commence an action for damages, regardless of whether the individual files a criminal complaint regarding the sexual abuse. This was full circle for Phil. And the best part, he brought it upon himself. In his fight to hide the truth, he was the most monumental in exposing it.
I am the king of exposing the truth.
I got a $2 million house out there. Now I got a $3.5 million one in St. Thomas. And I got, you know, another one out in Vegas. And I got another $3.5 million house out here in Havasu. You mad because of that?
Act 3, From Poor to Rich. The best way to understand the mind of a criminal is to study their past. When it comes to Phil Godlewski, we now know he committed sex crimes against a child from 2008 to 2010, and his passion to continue lying about it actually exposed the proof of it to the public. And as time progressed, this wouldn't be the only crime he would commit. In studying his lies and grifts post-2020, we'll learn the nature of his criminal mind, ultimately showcasing the belief that Phil thinks he can get away with anything. After interviewing a few people who grew up with Phil in the same town, it's been reported that his grandparents won the lottery and then purchased a gas station. It's alleged that Phil was the bookkeeper at the Subway and was caught stealing money from them. This would only mark the start of Phil's grifting career.
I would love to sit here and say that I regret breaking the law, but I don't.
The bad check. The fact that in 2021, Phil was found guilty for writing a $22,000 bad check says a lot about his habits for stealing other people's money and hard work. Godlewski issued the check November 13th to the Mariotti driver who delivered more than $23,000 worth of kitchen cabinets, granite countertops, and other supplies to cover the balance still owed on the materials. This crime went so far that Phil tried to cover his tracks by forging his bank documents, falsely claiming he had the money, and blamed Wells Fargo for not transferring the funds. Investigative reports showed he only had about $200 in his bank account when he wrote the check. He pled guilty to writing a bad check and tampering with records. In exchange, prosecutors dropped theft and forgery charges. He served a month in jail and was sentenced to 4 years of probation, which he is still currently serving. He has on video admitted no guilt for committing his crime, and he even posted himself flipping off the company which he robbed.
I would love to sit here and say that I regret breaking the law, but I don't.
What I find odd is that Phil mentions that he was an early investor in Bitcoin.
I made some good business decisions. I've been involved with Bitcoin very, very early, very early.
If that were true, why is he writing bad checks with only $200 in his bank account? When Phil sued the Scranton Times, he started a fundraiser and earned around $25,000 from his audience. In desperation to make more money, his grift was expanded to include the most profitable multi-layer marketing company, Goldco. He claims to have transferred over $500 million from 401ks into gold, stating his luxurious lifestyle is because of God rewarding him for the good he's done for others.
Those things are my reward for helping us get to where we are. And once it concludes, this is God's work. It's God's work. God put me in this position because I needed to be in this position. And if I excelled at this position, God would reward me for the rest of my life. And that is what God has done.
But upon review, a A Phil Fraud Stories group on Telegram highlights a very common experience with Phil and Gold Co. People trusted Phil, and Phil spoke often about the dollar collapsing, saying silver and gold would skyrocket any day now as the dollar collapse was imminent.
I'm not a financial advisor, but seeing what I see happen right now with inflation, it's unprecedented. It's disgusting. It makes me sick. I want to puke. Do you expect silver to start accelerating in value soon? Yes, I do. The IRA 401k rollover, you're going to want to do that.
He claims not to be a financial advisor, yet gives a lot of financial advice.
Sometime soon. Last word of advice, and I can't tell you. I can't tell you how important this is. Get your money out of a IRA or a 401k that's backed by real estate or backed by the stock market. I am transferring some of my Roth IRA to a company that I got off of Gold Quiz called Gold Co. You always said it's better to have it in hand. Is this a good choice? I would not put you guys in a position regarding your IRAs or 401ks that I did not think was a good choice. You're not getting the physical metals. in your hand. They will ship them to you if you want, but you're putting your IRA into a different currency. If you were referred to GoldCo via the goldquiz.com, the answer is yes. It is safe. If you still have a 401k invested in the stock market and you have not yet flipped that over to precious metals, shame on you. So if you guys still have, you know, your retirement and your savings in the stock market, particularly in a 401k or an IRA, you got to get that son of a bitch out of there. And the best way to do it is by going to goldquiz.com.
This was the start of what made him millions. All of the hard work others had put into their lifelong careers ended up in his pocket through commissions. It would be easy to think that maybe he was just misinformed and his promises about silver and gold were innocent, and that maybe he was just telling us what he thought was true. But he's actively sold items that were 100% fabricated. Welcome, Trump Bucks. While photoshopping Ivanka Trump holding fake Trump Bucks, Phil began to market and sell Trump Bucks on Telegram. Phil falsely advertised that they would soon be worth a lot in value. It's also alleged that he sold a lot.
Are you listening? Pay attention, this is very important. The Trump Golden $1,000 bill is something that I made to financially help all Americans, everyone, including you. The bill is amazing, okay? It is golden, and every bill has its worth.
So when his audience found out Trump Bucks had no value, he said he was marketing them for a friend and they weren't his. You see the pattern here, right? It's that greed is so profoundly abundant within his psyche that he'll do anything for money. He'll steal, he'll lie, and he'll cover it up. Snake venom filters.
Over the last few days, I have come up with a solution to help us.
When a viral documentary came out stating that COVID was released to the public through snake venom being added to the U.S. tap water supply, Phil was quick to start selling water filters.
And it took this long to be able to get to where we're at. We built out our own website, we built out our own e-commerce, and it's going to keep everyone here very, very safe.
No harm, really. That is until he stated his product was made to filter snake venom.
$79.95 will get you there. You could pour your regular tap water into the Seychelles filter, and it will remove everything in the water. By the way, all of the components of snake venom are also listed in the testing that was already done on Seychelles products. So all the stuff that would kill you or make you sick from any sort of venom from a snake, it is taken care of in their testing. There is a solution, and it's not expensive. And I strongly advise buying it.
He made a lot of money there too. When the company was asked about the snake venom claim, they denied it, confirming Phil was false advertising. In a rage from being caught, he had many of his followers leave one-star bad reviews for the company. He lies, he steals, he covers it up. This power Phil had over his followers would be used to an extreme shortly after. Salon owner in California, Christine McCaslin, had her name, business address, and more identifying information doxed by Phil. This ruined 20 years of reputation she had built, and shortly after, they terrorized her business and left false reviews online for everyone to see, and was forced to move locations under a new business name. And all of this for what? Openly criticizing Phil. He egged them on, and it led to the collapse of her business and reputation. She fought back and sued Phil, fighting the bully and setting an example for all of us. In Christine's declaration of motion, we learn the details of what happened. Christine writes, "In May 2023, Godlewski posted to his over 400,000 Telegram social media followers, on his account, a finger-pointing emoji, a bomb emoji, and a sunglasses emoji, along with my address, phone number, and other identifying information. I reached out to Godlewski in a private email exchange to inquire why he out of the blue doxed me. In the course of that private email exchange, I brought up the sexual allegations against him that were published by the Scranton Times-Tribune, the Daily Beast, and Rolling Stone magazine. In response to my email, he posted the private email exchange between us to his Telegram followers, along with my LinkedIn profile, including a photograph. Godlewski invited his followers to make negative customer reviews of my business, even if his followers had never been a customer of mine. In a video posted about his intentions, Godlewski announced his intent to inflict harm and turn my business into a taco stand.
I have no remorse for the people who are trying to put me down and saying false, defamatory, derogatory things about me. Each and every one of you will see me in court. I promise you, each and every one of you will see me in court. I will be there. You will have to talk to the judge and tell him why you did these things, and then we'll see where the law falls on your particular case. But if I have to do a tour of the United States in sections to attend the hearings involved in the different people that are purporting these lies against me, I'm coming. Salon Touche, I will own Salon Touche. I told her in an email this morning, I'm going to make it into a taco stand. Why? Because I love tacos. And every Tuesday, I'm going to have something that I think is a very good idea. I'm going to have Taco Tuesday. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. Probably not, because it's a really good idea. I'm going to have Taco Tuesday. And I'm probably going to put my name in there somehow, too. Like, I put my name in everything else, like Taco Tuesday, maybe Taco Foosday. I don't know, something like that. But nonetheless, we're going to do it. That's going to be my salon, and that's going to be my taco stand in Redondo Beach. I like Redondo Beach, actually. I think it's a nice area. So I think it's a great prime opportunity for a taco stand.
Godlewski's followers complied with his demands. Since May 2023, I have received over 1,000 negative reviews on Yelp and Google from members of the public who have never even used my services. They also made negative posts on my Facebook and Instagram business accounts. In addition, my phone number became essentially unusable because of the high volume use of the number by non-customers to harass me. In addition to the online harassment, there was and continues to be real-world harassment of me. On May 6th, 2023, a handwritten note with red writing was delivered to my business that read, "Your days are numbered, you filthy bitch." A few days later, a second handwritten note was delivered to my business that read, "You're gonna pay. Everyone will watch you burn." On May 7th, 2023, I sent an email to Godlewski asking why he published my salon information online, and he replied, "You don't intimidate me. Your arrest is coming soon. I will own your salon within a year." After his initial post, Godlewski made follow-up posts encouraging his followers to harass me further. This behavior is indicative of someone who has gone off his meds, someone who has severe bipolar rage, and is on a mission to hide the darkest truths about his past, projecting his own lack of self-worth onto others, claiming he'll take them down, own their businesses, yet every threat fails to see promise.
Sorry about that, locals. I'm like a rookie. Not really a live streamer anyway. I'm just a military intelligence agent.
There is no limit when it comes to Phil and his lies. There is direct benefit to each lie he tells, and that's money. Whether it's building trust established on lies or making sales based on fabrication, Phil will do whatever it takes to make more money. Money to him is power, but power yielded by a fool can and always will destroy him. By building himself up as someone important, he's created artificial fame so that he is never questioned, so then his viewers believe anything he says. Phil has alluded to being Q, to being Edward Snowden, to being Seth Rich, to also being the head of a secret military intelligence team that controls Trump, Flynn, and others. This is all to gain trust from his audience. The more trust he got, the more influence he had, the more things he sold, the more money he made. In watching his videos regarding going on missions, his lies become comical, and the idea that people believe him is not only shocking, but sad.
Something pretty important's going on right now, because I have just been summoned to go to New York City. I don't know exactly what's up yet, but I do know something's up. And I have a pretty good feeling that it's something big. I literally have 20 minutes to get on a flight. And I have 20 minutes to get on a flight. Well, I have 20 minutes to get to the airport, is what I should say. You guys will be updated as I go. I don't know how long I'm gonna actually be there. Whether it's gonna be a day or two or less, I really don't know. But what I do know is I need to hurry. If I land in time, I will try to go live or at least do another video later from where I'm headed. I know this is a crazy kind of very short. I know I'm not paying attention. I know my words are sporadic, but I have a feeling this might be something big. So keep your fingers crossed. Pray that I get to New York, please. This has to happen. Keep you guys posted as soon as I know more.
These are fake military operations. A secret agent would never broadcast their secret missions on Telegram. But what if an agent accidentally recorded himself? Would he accidentally post it? Phil claims he butt recorded himself on a mission, that is to say, recorded on accident, yet he still decided to upload the video of him leading this secret military operation from his porch while on his laptop.
Rank back, Bravo, 14. People. Event, Strick. Take 7. 15, Ego. Bronco.
People actually believe this.
Data, 4. 4, Trump, 19.
Not only is he leading not-so-secret operations, but he says he controls the 5.
Phil one of the five? Me? Am I one of the five? I would be six. There's the five, which I control. Not control, but it's I'm not going to get into that. But there's the five, and then there's me. And I do special things. That's enough. Scavino, one of the five. Yes? Let it be known that that's the first time I've ever revealed any members of the five. Is Flynn one of the five? Yes. Let it be known that's only the second time in the history of this show. Is Cash Patel one of the five? Yes. You guys are doing well tonight. Doing very well. Is the entity known as Edward Snowden part of the five? Yes.
His lies took an outlandish turn yet again.
Will the January 6th prisoners be released soon, or was that theater as well? I think that was theater. I don't think there's any January 6th prisoners. I think when Congress tried to visit them in jail, they were refused. January 6th prisoners, I don't think that there are any January 6th prisoners. I think that's a big hunk of baloney.
Well, I was there. I was locked up in solitary confinement with 25 to 30 other patriots. We are real, and it's very obvious. Phil is the fake.
We're here in the Capitol.
We are.
I'm here with my homie. What's your name again, homie?
Ed.
Oh, yeah, just like me. We're going to start a campaign.
I like the way you think.
Hey, do you smoke weed?
Not too often.
Hey, and not too often is someone going to hand out joints.
He is a grifting pedophile compulsive liar who doesn't realize his lies are so easily checked. The ones without the faculty of discernment are being so easily fooled into his bad acting. At this point, if they aren't paying attention, do they deserve to be scammed? How did they get to this point of belief without question? Well, Phil tricked them. He lied about the foundations of his character, his intelligence, and his following. Act 5, A Twist of Fake. A lot of people might watch this film and think, well, it's partially his audience's fault. They believed him. But you need to remember, he lied to his audience and made himself more than he actually was, taking advantage of other people based on lies he told about himself. For example, he lied about graduating from Harvard.
Harvard, yeah, I do have a Harvard degree. I don't know if you guys knew that or not. I have a bunch of degrees, actually. Harvard's one of them.
Your paper says certificate. That's all.
My
your paper says.
Did you read it? Because I can.
Oh yes, absolutely. I have a picture. I have a picture of it.
Okay, and it doesn't say anywhere on there.
It doesn't say. It's a certificate of completion.
Okay.
And he lied about being a member of the High IQ Institute, Mensa.
I have multiple college degrees. I'm a member of Mensa. I have a 148 IQ. This is my diploma.
We emailed Mensa, and they replied he wasn't in their system. For those who don't fact-check, it's no wonder they have fallen for his grift. Fake followers. Over the last 3 years, Phil Godlewski's following went from mediocre to extravagant. So much so that a lot of people believe the numbers are fake. Many have shown evidence that he is using web services that add bots as fake followers. The nature of purchasing bots comes with massive highs and lows in short spans of time, because bot accounts aren't actually people, and they get added and deleted in massive chunks. You can see evidence of that here. And here. We found this review on getafollower.com. Would Godlewski be stupid enough to actually write this review? I think so. Phil claims 10 to 20 million are watching his live stream on Rumble, when the watching live ticker actually shows 40,000.
Thanks for tuning in. We reached a peak viewership tonight of 29,170,000. That's a lot of people. We got over 13 million people watching tonight. So, first of all, we're about to break the internet tonight with the amount of viewers we have on right now. We are touching 20 million people right now. I expect that to fly by, that number.
He states non-account holders don't get added to the ticker.
Most of my listeners on Rumble are not registered users. You guys know that right now. Most of you watching me right now do not have a Rumble account, nor do you need one to watch. But Nick, you may want to know this. We had 18 million people at our top interval tuned in all at once watching this. The numbers are actually greater than that, but that was the consecutive viewership. That was the most consecutive viewership that we had. So you just had nearly 20 million people watch this. I know the numbers on Rumble don't reflect that, but those are only registered users that you see on Rumble. I also have four other platforms that I simulcast my live streams to. So you're getting a combination of four platforms plus all the unregistered viewers that don't have a Rumble account that were just watching this.
We emailed Rumble and they denied that. Fact-checking Phil has become fairly easy. Someone who lies this much for attention and money most certainly has a disorder, a disease. They are greed-possessed. And unless people like us call them out, they'll continue robbing others for their own personal gain. Part 3. Phil's finished. Karma never forgets an address. To those who backed down because of his threats of lawsuit, we understand you weren't strong enough. For those who don't know Phil, a lawsuit does become a threatening scare. But for those who know the truth, his barks are just noise and never action. Fear is his greatest weapon. Who else operates like this? Phil has threatened lawsuits to about 30 truthers in this movement, all for pointing out that he signed a guilty plea that stated the defendant Godlewski did engage in sexual intercourse with a minor child victim under the age of 16. Him suing anybody for stating facts goes to show he thinks money can erase his past. Oh, but what money can't buy. After scamming everyone, can you believe he flaunts his wealth? In a time where inflation is high and people are struggling, he exemplifies the trashiest behavior by bragging about his wealth, or how I see it, what he's robbed from others. The most sickening and completely a disgrace to the cross he wears around his neck was that he was caught red-handed sending explicit photos to another person while on his honeymoon taking photos with his small dick in hand. It doesn't get any worse than what comes next. He's not only robbed people of their hard-earned money, but it's very possible he's robbed people of life. I've been in communication with a relative of someone who committed suicide, and they say, in part, because of Phil. Through a wave of severe letdowns of failed promises regarding the imminent financial collapse and the rise in price of gold and silver, this person took their own life. There is an email trail between him and Phil, and it shows what led to his depression just before he took his own life. Let that sink in. This isn't the first time we've heard a story like this surrounding Phil. Let it be known, this led the mother to do a private investigation, and it's alleged the investigation uncovered Phil as a swinger, a possible bisexual, with an alleged extensive collection of anal toys. Our thoughts and prayers are with everyone who has been affected by Phil's lies, grifts, and deception. But if it wasn't for everyone sharing and fighting back, we'd never get to see the fall of Phil. In his attempts to scare me, he has shown how inadequate he truly is. If a lawsuit were to come my way, him being a public figure would put him in a very hard position to prove defamation. After all, my information comes from text messages, court documents, receipts. Unlike Phil, who relies solely on forged documents, fake reviews, stock accounts, and deceit. The end of Phil's lawsuit with the Scranton Times is coming closer. Even though he dragged his feet for 2 years during the discovery phase, fighting for extension after extension, while still not producing anything to his favor, the outcome is certain. Phil will lose. The ending to his lawsuit with Bree is also coming closer. She is gonna win her lawsuit. She has the smoking gun, the texts, and her word, and every lie that Phil has ever been caught in. All those will serve against him, and he'll finally pay for what he did to her in 2010. You see, Phil is a pedo, a grifter, a deceiver, a demon. What he's robbed from so many others has built him a nice little empire. But it appears God does have a sense of humor, because now, Phil is losing everything. The pain felt is never greater than when you build an empire off the back of others and lose it overnight. Phil will end up in jail again. It's a fact that he's being investigated by forces much larger than us. But the real question is, will he ever change? No, of course not. Phil was put here to help us change, to help us see what a scammer really looks like, to help us see what a grifter really sells like. He was put here to help us learn how a pedophile conducts himself. Lastly, I believe he was put here to help us realize what a disgusting demon will try to get away with unless others stop him first. I believe he was put here to help us realize the power we have together when it comes to exposing those who take advantage of other people. For those who have fallen victim to his lies and are still in the hypnotic gematria decode everything spell, the only thing that will wake you up now is Phil, through his own idiocracy, sheer stupidity, and greed. Those worthy of waking up actually will, but maybe, just maybe, the ones who don't are here to teach us something too. That not all who are sleeping are meant to wake up.
Great job, Nick. Thank you all for tuning in. I'm incredibly, incredibly impressed with what we just saw. And let me tell you something else. That film that you just saw should be a wake-up call. It should be a giant wake-up call.
Hey, friends, won't you listen? I'm afraid we've got too high. Hey, America, America, you're never gonna reach the sky. But I can see you sailing way up there. Trying to poke a hole in the firmament, but you're going nowhere. Hey, I'm not saying if it's right or it's wrong, because I know that's how it's gonna be. It's been our choice all along, but there's still some people just can't see that it's coming closer. It's coming closer. Hey, what's the matter? Where's your smile gone to, my friend? I know you want these endless, senseless wars to end, but just have patience, it's election time again. And they'll tell us there's peace, but we'll know it's just pretend. Hey, wait a minute, hold on, hey, let me guess. There's something else you wanna protest. It's not just the wars, it's the world that's getting you down. You're not alone, take a good look around. You'll see it's coming closer. It's coming been disturbing your decided ways. There's so much going around us in these troubled days. It could be different this time, it could be anyways. But there's still time for peace and love and grace. Hey, I'm not saying if it's good or it's bad. Hey, I'm just saying that's the way it should be. Just can't see that it's coming closer. It's coming closer. It's coming.
Run on for a long time.